Greetings and welcome. We're glad that you are here with us today as we gather on the third Sunday of Advent. The presider for today's liturgy is Father John, and in today's liturgy we are remembering Raymond Mazza. So that we might pray and sing as one family, please stand and greet those around you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with each of you.
And with your spirit.
So we've come to the third Sunday of Advent, also known as Gaudete Sunday, rejoice, as our Advent celebration, or Advent observance, I should say, is winding down and coming towards the end. Before we enter these sacred mysteries, we take a moment to reflect on the events of recent days. And for those times you've not been true to our call, we ask for God's pardon, grace, and strength in the future. Have mercy on us, O Lord.
For we have sinned against you.
Show us, O Lord, your mercy.
And grant us your salvation.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who see how your people faithfully await the feast of the Lord's Nativity, enable us, we pray, to attain the joys of so great a salvation and to celebrate them always with solemn worship and glad rejoicing. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord anointed me. He has sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to announce a year of favor from the Lord and a day of vindication by our God. I rejoice heartily in the Lord, and my God is the joy of my soul. For he has clothed me with a robe of salvation and wrapped me in a mantle of justice, like a bridegroom adorned with a diadem and a bride bedecked with jewels. As the earth brings forth its plants, and a garden makes its growth spring up, so will the Lord God make justice and praise spring up before all nations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lowly servant from the stale generation.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Brothers and sisters, rejoice always, pray without ceasing. In all circumstances, give thanks, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophetic utterances. Test everything. Retain what is good. Refrain from every kind of evil. May the God of peace make you perfectly holy, and may you entirely, spirit, soul, and body, be preserved blameless for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will also accomplish it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
A man named John was sent from God. He came for testimony, to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to him to ask him, "Who are you?" he admitted and did not deny it, but admitted, "I am not the Christ." So they asked him, "What are you then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you? So that we can give an answer to those who sent us. What do you have to say for yourself?" He said, "I am a voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet said." Some Pharisees were also sent, and they asked him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ or Elijah or the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." This happened in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Have you ever found out something good about someone that you never heard before, never knew before? I'm not talking about a casual acquaintance. I'm talking about someone at least you think you know well. Someone you thought you had a pretty good picture of. You know, for example, one day you're at a party for a neighbor you've known for 20 years. And someone talks about the neighbor's purple heart. And you wonder, how come I never heard about that? Or one of your coworkers one afternoon over coffee mentions that someone else from the office volunteers every week as an overnight caregiver at a homeless shelter. And you think, what? Or you discovered that the woman you've been in yoga class for over a year is a Rhodes Scholar. And you think, well, how come she never mentioned that? I always feel good when I hear those sorts of things, when something wonderful done by someone else comes to light. But truth be told, I also feel a little guilty. A little guilty that perhaps I am not that humble. But at the same time, it's nice to know that there are people who don't need to go on and on and on about how wonderful they are. They don't need people to constantly remind them how wonderful they are. The opposite of humility are persons whose conversations might be summarized like this. Well, that's enough about me. What do you think of me? In today's gospel, John the Baptist doesn't fall into that trap. As we hear, all sorts of people are rushing out to him in the desert, convinced that he is Elijah or one of the prophets or even the Messiah. And John could have basked in their attention, their adulation. It would have been easy, but he resists that temptation to make it about himself. He knows his place in the grand scheme. He is a messenger. He points the direction away from himself and toward God in their midst. As we heard, there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is to come after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie. Having that sort of humility, that sort of understanding of one's place in the world and one's relationship to others is a rare wisdom in our day. I'm sure it exists, and I hope that it's more common than I imagine. There are certainly people who do things for which they want no credit, but in our world, that's truly countercultural. In our world, the temptations are overwhelming and the cultural pull is great to tell nearly everyone, everything, anything about ourselves with the click of a button. You know, think of Facebook or Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. It's hard to resist because each of us have the power to create the person we dream about being and see how many likes we get. I love myself. I think I'm grand. And so I wonder what the long-term effects will be on us as human beings. Will we simply evolve and change? And will we be better or worse? We will probably never find out with any real clarity. But it does seem that we are getting to a point where we spend many hours and hours of our days making sure that everyone knows everything about us, our opinions, our accomplishments, and the minutiae of our daily lives. And we do that through photos and videos. And then we spend more hours consumed waiting for positive affirmation, a like or a comment telling us how awesome we are. Healthy? I don't think so. It's unhealthy, not just from a human development or a social point of view, but from a spiritual perspective also. Because Christianity is about living for others. And Jesus shows us in a perfect and concrete way, in so many ways, really, the importance of pouring out our lives for others, for spouses and children and friends and strangers, and even for our enemy. Being a faithful disciple is about embracing others, not about me. Living a Christian life is about being in relationship with God and others. I imagine that some of you are sitting there thinking, boy, is he an old man, stuck in the past. Times have changed, things have changed. The way we do things have changed. Technology has changed us. The way we relate to one another has changed. I don't dispute any of that. The question is, as the world changes, from my perspective, very rapidly, don't we owe it to God and ourselves to just pause and reflect on the way we live in the world? Shouldn't we pause and try to figure out what we are embracing? And is it luring us to an unhealthy place? To a place in which we strive to make ourselves the center of everything? A place where everyone, including God, revolves around us or around me? The readings of Advent encourage us to examine our lives and to identify where we might change our lives to put our Christian faith at the center of our living. In the gospel reading, John the Baptist points to Jesus as the Messiah and reminds us who is to be the center of our lives. Let us now stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Confident that God hears and answers our prayers, we put the needs of our world and communities, we perceive them before the throne of heaven.
For the Church, that our words and actions may testify to the light, so that others may realize the goodness of God in what we say and do. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That justice and peace may spring up before all nations, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prophets of our time, who boldly proclaim the truth as they stand up for what is right, good, and worthy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Jewish sisters and brothers who have begun celebrating Hanukkah, the festival of lights, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the brokenhearted, captives and prisoners, that they may know a year of favor from the Lord, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died and for the consolation of their loved ones, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our own intentions, we pause and pray. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All powerful and ever loving God, on this Gaudete Sunday, as we celebrate the third Sunday of Advent, we ask you especially to give ear to our prayers, to listen to our cares and concerns, and in your mercy, grant what you will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be found acceptable to God, the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
O Lord, may the sacrifice of our worship be offered to you unceasingly to complete what was begun in sacred mystery and powerfully accomplish for us your saving work through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and opened for us the way to eternal salvation. That when he comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which now we dare to hope. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walks with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst, whom we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for his disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis our Pope, Thomas our Bishop, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all peoples may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At our Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever."
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Upon our darkness, Lord,
Let us pray. Lord, we implore your mercy that this divine sustenance may cleanse us of our faults and prepare us for the coming feast through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.